The next case to come before the court is the State of Ohio versus William Hunter, and you're both on that case as well. So I can reiterate your 15 minutes that you each have in your 5 minutes for rebuttal if you like, or if you're ready to proceed.
Ready to go.
Okay, thank you.
Again, I'm pleased to sign the court. My name is Thomas Ryan, representing the defendant appellant, William Hunter, and I'd like to reserve, if I may, 5 minutes for rebuttal. So Mr. Hunter exercised his right to a jury trial, was convicted of several counts, including complicity in aggravated trafficking in drugs, and another count for that as well. So what happened in this case, drug deal set up, task force got set up, they used some accomplices to testify in this particular case. There's some testimony from one of the state's accomplice witnesses that a gun was thrown or some object was thrown in the back seat. So I'm asking the civil court to reverse the conviction as relates to Mr. Hunter, at least so far as the firearms specification goes. And here's why. So I've been doing this for 29 years, both as assistant county prosecutor in Cuyahoga County, defense attorney, with the federal court, worked all over the state. I've never seen a situation where the firearm is recovered and not tested. It was not test fired. Obviously, it can be proved, firearm can be proved to be operable from the statute through circumstantial evidence. But when you have the firearm, it's tested. It was not tested in this case. Nevertheless, he was convicted of that 1 year firearm specification and sentenced to a consecutive sentence for that in relation to that specific conviction for the firearm specification. I submit that's not ample evidence under sufficiency standard to go forward when you have the firearm. Again, revised code 2923.11, E1 defines firearm, meaning any deadly weapon capable of expelling or propelling one or more projectiles by the action of an explosive or combustible propellant. Firearm includes any unloaded firearm and any firearm that is inoperable that can be rendered operable. It just wasn't test fired. It just wasn't done. They never checked it. I don't know why not. Certainly there's case law that a firearm specification can be proved by circumstantial evidence. In fact, if somebody says, give me your money, and that victim says, it looks like a gun, I thought it was a gun, he made threats with that gun, I have a gun, I'm gonna shoot you, something along those lines, that can be considered circumstantial evidence. But I submit when you have the firearm, it needs to be test fired. It was not done in this particular case. And therefore, how can you determine operability to sustain conviction? It simply wasn't done in this case. I don't know why. I don't understand why. I've never seen that before.
I don't remember. Were there bullets in the gun?
I don't recall. I do not recall.
Because if there were bullets, that'd be circumstantial evidence that it was operable.
Not necessarily. It wasn't test fired. I mean, there's been guns. It's got to be test fired. I submit when you have the gun. If you have the gun, it should be test fired.
Well, I definitely think that's a better procedure.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
But is it necessary? And you're saying that the case law where it says it can be proven by circumstantial evidence is just in a situation where the gun is never recovered.
I submit all those cases that I cited were where firearms were proved, they were proved by circumstantial evidence, where the police or law enforcement did not physically actually have the gun. Before a gun becomes a firearm, it has to be determined in terms of operability. In other words, capable of emitting a projectile. It was not done in this particular case.
Is there a case law supporting that? In your brief, I can't recall.
No. No, I've just never seen it before. Because every case I've ever had, thousand cases I've ever had, when they have the gun, it's always been test fired. And then when they don't have the gun,
What about in the where firearms define it? It says, but a firearm can include an unloaded firearm and any firearm that is inoperable but can readily be rendered operable.
Well, by in here, so okay, the first part. Repeat the first part.
Includes any unloaded firearm.
Right. Okay. Unloaded. Right.
And any firearm that is inoperable but can be readily rendered operable.
So if it's unloaded. They can still fire. They still test it. And I've had situations like that, handle cases like that, where the firearm is unloaded, and they, law enforcement, ballistics testing, they put projectile, and they put a bullet in it to see if it's operable. I've had cases like that before. Let's take a murder case, for example. Somebody shoots somebody, the revolver holds 6 shots, gun's completely unloaded, so it's an unloaded gun. They recover the gun. That gun is test fired by other bullets, other projectiles at the lab. So that's a situation like that. And the second part of that is?
Inoperable but capable of being rendered inoperable.
Right. That means, in other words, sometimes you might have like a little pin or something you have to put in there or something, or you have to take a safety off or something along those lines. But actually, there's no testimony at all to that. The cases I cited, Gaines, Murphy, those cases were based upon circumstantial evidence of witnesses who said, yes, fired the gun, or threatened me with the gun, worse to the fact that the gun was real, or gun to put in my back, and it was a hard object, and I felt it was a gun because he said, if you move, I'm going to shoot you, something along those lines. So I submit that firearm specification in this particular case. Has to be vacated, has to go. Additionally, no DNA found on the gun. No fingerprints found on the gun. We have accomplice testimony, and in this case, so whether that's to be believed or not, I submit that falls on the manifest weight argument as well, and it's not sufficient evidence to sustain a firearm conviction under that argument as well. And again, jury instructions. Whenever accomplices testify under revised code 2923.03, there is a mandatory jury instruction. And when charging the jury under Section D, the court in charge of the jury shall state substantially the following. The testimony of an accomplice does not become inadmissible because of his complicity, moral turpitude, or self-interest, but the admitted or claimed complicity of a witness may affect his credibility, make his testimony subject to grave suspicion, and require that it be weighed with great caution. The state submits that some part of that was done, but not all of it, and it says shall state. Again, and then the second part is, it is for you, the jurors, in light of all the facts presented to you from the witness stand, to evaluate such testimony and to determine its quality and worth, or its lack of quality and worth. So not only is there a jury instruction to that effect, there's actually case law, or actually revised code, the legislature saw fit to put in that type of law because it's so important in terms of evidence. And I've cited some cases to say that it is error, and plain error, to not give that accomplice testimony instruction. So my arguments are basically twofold in this particular case. Number one, insufficient evidence to sustain the firearm specification. Number two, the jury instructions were screwed up because they were not properly given this case, and that rises to the level of error, which requires that my client's convictions and sentence be vacated and or reversed.
You're not arguing that the OJI instruction, word for word, has to be given by the court?
No, because it says shall substantially. It says substantially, but I submit it wasn't substantially done in this particular case because it missed basically the whole paragraph that I just read. Basically just says, you missed half the instruction. I mean, the court threw in a couple words in there maybe as opposed to a whole paragraph. So it's kind of makeshift quick, do, go. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. I'm Vince Bellucci with the Medina County Prosecutor's Office for the appellee in the state of Ohio. I'll start with the sufficiency argument on the firearm spec. Hunter, of course, argues there's no evidence the gun was test fired. That's true. That was not presented at the trial, but the state of Ohio was not required to prove that it was test fired. To prove that it was operable or could be rendered operable, as Judge Schaefer mentioned. No case or statute anywhere requires test firing to prove something's a firearm, right? I think Mr. Ryan even admitted that. He's just basically saying, well, I've never seen it, so that must be what the law is. Well, that's not what the law is. There is no law saying that. In fact, it says quite the opposite. It says you can prove something as a firearm through lay witness testimony, through circumstantial evidence, pretty much anything. Just like in so many other areas of the law, what you have here is a totality of the circumstances test for whether something is a firearm. And you've got quite a few circumstances in this case.
So you're basically saying it doesn't matter whether it's operable?
No, I think...
as long as it's a firearm. Somebody comes in and says this is a firearm.
Well, I think circumstantial evidence can prove that it's a firearm and can also prove that it is operable or can be rendered operable as well. Circumstantial evidence can prove that whole definition, I think.
Okay. So what was here? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, if you look at Murphy, I think was mentioned that just talks about, you know, you can use lay witnesses, the surrounding circumstances. Tompkins as well is another sort of big Supreme Court case that talks about an implicit threat made by a defendant. Now, in that case, I believe it was in the context of an armed robbery where the gun wasn't recovered, maybe thrown in a sewer drain or something. But that just proves right there that if you've got so many cases like that where the gun isn't recovered and you still have the defendant being convicted of a firearm spec, clearly you don't have to have you don't even have to have the gun necessarily as evidence to convict somebody of a firearm spec.
So what was the circumstantial evidence here that was operable?
Well, there was quite a bit, and Tompkins talks about the implicit threat. Well, the other two individuals, the co-defendants who were in the car, were all operating under Hunter's implied threat, basically, on this particular day. You had Ms. Guarino, I think is how you pronounce it, and Mr. Thomas, who both testified at trial. And in terms of their testimony, so Thomas, first of all, says he didn't have a gun, and Ms. Guarino didn't have a gun on that particular day. Hunter did, however, he testified, have a gun the day before. He saw Hunter with a gun. He saw him pull it out, and he actually saw him threaten somebody with the gun just the day before.
Did he say it was the same weapon?
He wasn't able to say that, no. In fact, he didn't actually say that he saw Hunter with the gun on this particular day. I will say that. He did not say that. Maria Guarino testified that just a few weeks earlier, Hunter had pulled a gun on her and threatened her because she owed him money. I think that's Guarino.
Again, with those specific testimony that it was the same gun.
Correct. Good, that's correct. Now, Maria Guarino, significantly also, she tells the Drug Task Force on the day of where all this happens, she tells the Drug Task Force that right as they were being pulled over by the Drug Task Force after this transaction takes place, she sees Hunter reach into his waist, pull out an object, and throw it behind the passenger seat of the car. He's driving. He just throws it right over behind the passenger seat. She said it was something heavy that made a thud. That's exactly where Agent Carroll found the gun in this case, which was a loaded 38 caliber revolver.
And I'm sorry to keep interrupting, but where was she seated in the vehicle?
She was in the front seat. She was the front passenger. Thomas was in the back seat. Now, in terms of, again, the gun was found immediately after watching a drug deal take place. This was a controlled buy with a confidential source by our drug task force. And Ms. Guarino actually gets out of the car and does the actual exchange. But Mr. Thomas testified in detail about what happens before that, which is, I'll get into that a little bit later, but basically Hunter hands her the drugs, tells her to go do it. She's actually under threat. She doesn't want to do it. He tells her to do it.
She's under threat not to get drugs for herself.
Correct. And potentially violence, given just a few weeks ago she had a gun pulled on her by Hunter when he wasn't doing exactly what she wanted him to do, which was
But she didn't testify this time that he threatened her with a gun or even shoot her.
No. She did not say that on this day. He pulled a gun on her, but had happened in the past.
So I guess I'm still going back to, because this is, you know, this is what we have to decide. You're telling us evidence, giving us evidence that it was his gun, but I'm still not sure I understand where the operability comes in. And if you're saying you don't have to prove operability, that's one thing, but it seems like you're still saying that you do have to demonstrate at trial that the gun was operable. That
no.
It's not enough that there's just, that there's a gun.
Well, that's the whole thing. I think something isn't a gun, or a firearm is the term of art, I guess.
Okay, a firearm.
So that's a defined term, but no, I don't think you have to. You can prove that something that a firearm is a, it's a gun that is, that can be rendered operable or is operable by circumstantial evidence.
Right, and that's what I'm trying to figure out. What is your circumstantial evidence? Because you said that your informant, or not your informant, but the co-defendant testified that he had used a gun previously, but they couldn't testify that this was the gun that they had seen him use previously.
Correct. Also that he had pulled something out just before he was pulled over, threw it right down behind the passenger seat where the gun was found.
Right, but that goes to him owning the gun and being in possession of the gun. But how does that go to operability?
Well,
I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I'm just trying to figure this out myself.
Does it matter that it was loaded?
I think so, sure. And you mentioned that as well. It was loaded. And it was his car. It was a stolen car, but there was a lot of things tying him to that car as well. A lot of documents were found in the car with his name on it in various places, which ties him to both the drugs. There was a lot of drugs found in the car and the gun that tied him to it. And Mr. Ryan didn't really get into it much, but there's a second assignment of error that's really a manifest weight argument where he kind of tries to pin the whole thing on this Mr. Thomas, who also testified as his co-defendant. Mr. Thomas's testimony told a very different story. That and certainly Mr. Thomas and Ms. Garino had substantial parts in this drug transaction, and they were charged accordingly. But I think Mr. Hunter had the most vital part of this drug transaction. These were his drugs. That's where the drugs came from. He's the one that wanted to do this deal. He wanted to drive up from Cleveland down to Brunswick and do this deal. It was his car. He provided the transportation. Really, what Thomas did was just set up the transaction. He admits that in his testimony. He set up the drug deal. He texted and called the man that ended up being the Drug Task Force's confidential source to set up the drug deal. But it was really, it was Hunter that was supplying the drugs, fentanyl and crack cocaine. Hunter was the one that wanted to do the deal. There was a small box near the driver's door that Thomas testified about. He actually he told the Drug Task Force about that. When the Drug Task Force searched the car, they found exactly what Thomas described, a small box, small storage compartment just to the left of the steering wheel that had a lot of drugs inside. He was linked very strongly to the drugs and to the gun that was found in the car. In terms of the accomplice testimony instruction, the trial court did give an accomplice testimony instruction, and that's actually found at pages 467 to 468 of the transcript. The language wasn't quoted verbatim, but this court has held that the language does not have to be verbatim, it just has to substantially comply. Even if you just look at the statute, it says substantially this. I think Mr. Ryan admitted that it's got to be substantial compliance. The language was stated somewhat out of order, but that's not something that matters. There's never been a case that said that matters. Most important part of the instruction, stating that the accomplice testimony should be viewed with grave suspicion and weighed with great caution. Those are the famous words. Those were quoted verbatim by the trial court, basically telling the jury, hey, you know, view this testimony with a cautious eye. That's the message, and that's clearly the message that got across here. And this, again, was not objected to at the trial level. So we're talking about plain error here, but there was no plain error argument made on this, how this would have affected anything. It sounds like Mr. Ryan is saying, is admitting that there was an accomplice testimony instruction given. That's not what he's, what was said in the brief. It sounded like he was saying it was omitted altogether. But I think we have agreement that there was an instruction given.
In regard to that, the judge said it was for them to judge credibility, the jurors. You know, standard, obviously, jury instruction in regard to that. But with the accomplice, it says that the fact that he's an accomplice may affect his credibility. And that wasn't given, was it?
What's that?
That was not charged to the jury, that the fact that he's an accomplice may affect his credibility.
I don't recall the exact quote. It's up to you to judge the credibility versus it may affect the credibility. I think that's just about just semantics. I think it's pretty close. It's conveying the same message. It's your job to judge credibility. You should look at this testimony with grave suspicion and weigh it with great caution. I mean, he quotes that exactly. So, I mean, that is really the most significant part of that instruction. So, I have much time remaining.
2.5 minutes.
Okay. Again, I think it's important that when you look at the testimony of Ms. Carino and Mr. Thomas, the theme of both of them was that there was an implicit threat from Hunter, that he had had a gun in the past, and that they were acting under that implicit threat. Because I think Tompkins talks specifically about a threat from a gun being circumstantial evidence, and even an implicit threat, not necessarily even an explicit threat, of having a gun, and then pairing that with tossing the object behind the seat exactly where it was found.
Was Mr. Thomas in the back seat then?
Yes.
Did he testify that Hunter threw the gun in the back seat?
He did not.
Was he asked?
I'm not sure if he was. I want to say he wasn't.
Okay.
Because both of these, you'll see in the record, their testimony is kind of all over the place. Obviously, these are individuals that are somewhat concerned about incriminating themselves as well, and are co-defendants in the case. So it wasn't always the easiest testimony to elicit. In fact, Ms. Carino does not say at trial that she saw him pull an object out and throw it. I think that came in through a drug task force agent that she told on the day of. Mm-hmm. So I don't think she even says that actually at trial, but she did say it on the day in question. So just to clarify that as well. Are there any further questions? I'll just ask this court to affirm the judgment of the trial court. Thank you.
Attorney Ryan, you have 5 minutes.
Right.
I'm sorry.
May it please the court. So, two key state's witnesses, co-defendants, accomplices. This is what the state is relying on to sustain and get convictions on this. So here's what Deanna Thomas and Maureen Torino. So Deanna Thomas gets a deal. He's going to get 6 months. He's pleading to F4 and F5 drug trafficking. His deal, he's going to get 6 months local time. Marie is going to get communicable sanctions after pleading guilty to drug trafficking. So let's start there, number one. Number two, two things as to that gun. Number one, the only way they can prove the firearm specification, the only way the state can prove the firearm specification is to show, and for the state to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, operability. So what the state's trying to do is circumvent the process and saying, well, there's enough evidence to do that. So number one, in terms of sufficiency or manifest weight, there's not enough evidence, I submit, to prove or to establish that Mr. Hunter even possessed or had the firearm on that day. In fact, Deauto Thomas, at transcript 266, and by the way, he's got prior convictions for having a weapon while on disability, went to prison for that. So what does Deauto Thomas say? Transcript 266. He did not see appellant put the gun in the back seat, does not know how it got there. So that's the state circumstantial evidence as to Deauto Thomas. There is nothing to show operability of the firearm. As to Marie Gerino, who testified that she was, quote, high, scared, three sheets to the wind, unquote, on transcript 301, specifically, she did not know that he had the gun that day. She did not see him put anything behind the passenger seat and did not see anything because it was dark. That's all 301. She did not see him reach behind the passenger seat and drop something, transcript 301. Kind of like the old Wendy's commercial, where's the beef? There's no evidence here that he even had the gun that particular day. There's no evidence he possessed the gun. And certainly, that circumstantial evidence does not suffice to sustain a conviction as to operability because they can't even put the firearm as to them. Those are the two key witnesses to try to establish operability of the firearm, those two? No. That's why there's the big problem here that the state did not have the gun actually test fired. So therefore, the operability issue, I submit, is out, and the firearm specification, at the very least, has to be dismissed and vacated. Thank you very much.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement and issue a decision, which will be mailed to both sides as well as posted tomorrow on the site of the Supreme Court.
Thank you.
Thank you.